Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billahil aliyyil azim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Wa sallallahu ala sayyidina wa nabiyyina Abil Qasim al-Mustafa Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Wa ala alihi at-tayyibin at-tahirin la siyama baqiyatillahi fil ardhin. Ajjalallahu ta'ala farajahu ash-sharif wa ja'alana min a'wanihi wa ansarih. This is our second session on happiness and how to achieve happiness. Last night I started with defining what is the meaning of happiness or pleasure in the way that our great philosophers have explained, and then opposite to it, which is pain. Because we said happiness is to have maximum pleasure and minimum pain. And then we explained that happiness is a matter of recognition or understanding of what is pleasant, what is good. And we said the greatest happiness or joy or bahja is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has the greatest understanding of the most perfect thing, which is He Himself. So He has the greatest joy, the greatest happiness, the greatest bahja. Then those who get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they also increase in their happiness because of their understanding of Allah increasing. So among human beings, those who have greatest understanding of Allah would have the greatest joy. And those who have the least understanding of Allah, they would have greatest pain. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran says, "Man a'radha an dhikri fa inna lahu ma'ishatan dhanka." Those who turn away from my remembrance, they would have very difficult life, a miserable life. Why? Because they are deprived from this great source of happiness. Then I started explaining the concept of nearness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we said nearness to Allah cannot mean here something which is based on just a contract or a decision made by a person or by an authority. It's a real thing. Those who are closer to Allah, they are really different from those who are not close to Allah. It's not like a person that in an office is given promotion, so his rank comes up and he's closer to the boss. But this person has not changed in reality. After 1 hour, he may lose his job. He's the same person, just the function has changed because of a decision made. On a piece of paper, they say, now today you are head of this part. After 1 hour, they say you are not anymore. But if you are closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's a real thing. You are really different from what you used to be. You are really different from the people who are not in this position. Then I said, when our scholars want to explain what is this reality, what is this change that has happened, they use different things. I mentioned the idea of resembling Allah more in His qualities. I mentioned the idea of understanding Allah through knowledge by presence. And then I said, I want to bring my own understanding based on the Quran, so that we can perhaps more easily and also more compatible with the Quranic system explain this concept. So we referred to the story of Pharaoh and magicians. In two places in the Quran, we have this conversation between the magicians and Pharaoh. Magicians told Pharaoh, أَإِنَّ لَنَا لَأَجْرًا إِن كُنَّا نَحْنُ الْغَالِبِينَ. If we manage to defeat Musa, Are we going to be rewarded? Are we going to be paid? Is there any gift, any payment for us? So as I said, they wanted to settle this issue, fix the payment, because they were worried that Pharaoh later may forget. When he finishes the job, then he may not bother about us. So now that he needs us, we can fix the payment. Also, they were so confident about their own achievement and their own performance that they said, we don't charge you if you don't win. But if we win, are you going to give us something? What is that? And kunna nahnu al-ghalibin. You know, like some, you know, lawyers, they say, you know, if we win the case, we charge you. If we don't win, we don't charge you. So he said, a'inna lana la'ajran in kunna nahnu al-ghalibin. And Fir'aun said, na'am. Yes, definitely I'm going to give you your reward, your payment. But I have even something greater for you. وَإِنَّكُمْ لَمِنَ الْمُقَرَّبِينَ I will raise you. I will elevate you to the position of مُقَرَّبِين. So then we reflected on two types of relation. Relation of a person who is hired for a job. He does something and then he receives his payment. And the relation of someone who is close, who is near to Pharaoh or a king, or later we said, even with the case of Allah. If your relation is the relation of employee and employer, the one who works and the one who pays, then no matter how generous is that person, still the reward would be based on your performance. Maybe 2 times more, 10 times more, but it's based on your performance. If you don't do anything, you don't receive anything. And if you do something good, you will be paid. But don't expect him to give you for something that you have not done. Or don't expect him to listen to you, give you a special, you know, treatment. No, you have done something, okay, this is the payment. But if you are muqarrab, then we said certain things apply. Muqarrab is the one who can be paid without doing anything. Muqarrab is given gift. The day of Eid comes, king gives him something. The birth anniversary of the king, king gives him something. His child is born, he gives him something. So Pharaoh, if he's choosing someone to be muqarrab to him, doesn't ask him what you have done for me. He thinks, how can I make this person happy? So it's not based on performance, it's based on love that this person has for the one who is muqarrab. The second thing is that the one who is muqarrab can anytime ask to meet the one to whom he is muqarrab. If you are muqarrab, even we said, you know, the security people know that you are muqarrab to Pharaoh. So they let you in. They don't stop you, because they know if they stop you, then you will later say to Pharaoh, you know, this person didn't let me to come. And Pharaoh will get angry. You didn't know that he's muqarrab to me? So anytime he can go and meet. The third thing is, he can intercede also for other people. An employee cannot do shafa'a for other people. You did something for me, you received your payment, what else you want? But when you are muqarrab, then you know that you will not be disappointed. You can ask him for yourself or for other people. So when people have haja, they go and find who is muqarrab. Please, you know, go and tell Pharaoh that I have this request. And Pharaoh, because of you, would give my request. So then we said, now that based on Quran, we analyzed the concept of muqarrab, now we can extend it to those who are muqarrab to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So who is the one who is muqarrab to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The one that has gone from the position of an employee or someone who works for reward, for payment, to the one who has very close relation as a person. It's no matter a matter of what you have done, you know, how many hours, how many rak'ah, how many recitation. No, it's a matter of, because of I love you, I give you. So you would be given even without doing anything. Because you have passed this stage. He may give you unconditionally and without expectation. You can meet him anytime. You can do shafa'ah for other people. Now, I want to bring you some evidence that this is something. Of course, even without evidence, this is clear so far. But I want to make it even more clear. So, if you reflect on this beautiful hadith of Qurb Nawafil. This is the hadith that you find it nearly in every book written about Islamic spirituality, you know. This is very well-known hadith. What I am quoting here is mentioned in Kafi, and the late Sheikh Kulaini has mentioned this in Al-Kafi, but you find it also in other books. According to this hadith, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, because this is hadith Qudsi, Imam Sadiq alayhi salam, according to this version, says that the Prophet said, and then the Prophet said that Allah said. This is hadith Qudsi, because this is what Allah said, but it is not part of the Quran. So it's not wahy, but it is word of God. قال سمعت أبا عبد الله عليه السلام يقول قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم قال الله قال الله عز وجل. So this is what Allah said. There is a sentence. To save time, I move to the second sentence. وما تقرب إلي عبد بِشَيْءٍ أَحَبَّ إِلَيَّ مِمَّا افْتَرَضْتُ عَلَيْهِ. No servant of mine, no person, has come closer to me by doing anything which is more loved by me than doing wajibat. So nothing can be like performance of wajibat. Because I love wajibat more than anything else. Not because Allah needs our performance of wajibat. Because Allah knows that our performance of wajibat is the greatest need that we have. So Allah says, if you want to come closer to me, if you want to have energy to ascend, the main source of energy is wajibat. If you, you know, are familiar in, with usul al-fiqh, our ulama have beautiful explanation here. They say anything that benefits us in our journey towards Allah, towards perfection, if the benefit is so high that without that we cannot reach Allah, then it becomes wajib. If the benefit is high, but still it's possible that without that we reach Allah, it becomes mustahab. So if there is maslahat mulzame, means a compelling interest, then it's wajib. So without wajibat, it's impossible to reach Allah, but mustahabat help you to reach Allah, but still it's possible. Maybe very slowly, maybe to some lower level, but still it's possible. But without wajibat, it's not possible. So the most important thing, the most loved thing, is to do your wajibat. مَا تَقَرَّبَ إِلَيَّ عَبْدٌ بِشَيْءٍ أَحَبَّ إِلَيَّ مِمَّا افْتَرَضْتُ عَلَيْهِ. So nothing can be done by my servant that I love more than wajibat. Okay? Please pay attention to this term, taqarrab. Taqarrab means seeking closeness. Means you are moving towards Allah, but still you are not near. Mutaqarrib is the one who is moving but still is not near. Okay. Wa innahu la yataqarrabu ilayya bin nafilah. After performance of wajibat, he keeps coming closer by doing recommended actions. La taqarrabu ilayya bin nafilah. So if you just do wajibat, you cannot become muqarrab. If you just do wajibat, you cannot prove your love to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is only when you do something that is not compulsory that you can really prove your love. Because if it is compulsory, okay, the reason is that you are worried that you will be punished. If you don't do it, you will be punished. But when something, Allah says, I love this, but I don't punish you if you don't do it. And then you still do it. This shows that you really love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, one of the reasons why Salatul Layl is so effective and so powerful is because it is not wajib. And those who wake up and get up from their bed in the middle of night and do something that Allah loves but it's not wajib, then these are the real lovers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But those who don't do this and do wajibat, they cannot prove their love for Allah. This is why Allah says in a hadith, كَذَبَ مَنْ ذَعَمَ أَنَّهُ يُحِبُّنِي فَإِذَا جَنَّهُ اللَّيْلِ نَامَ عَنِّي. The one who says he loves me, but when it's dark, instead of using this opportunity and this privacy and come to me, he sleeps and forgets me. Nama anni. It's very difficult to translate this in English. Nama anni means he sleeps, paying no interest to me, showing no interest. This person is a liar. And I think this is unfortunately a common problem. So, mustahab is very important. Not at the level of wajibat, but after performance of wajibat, to prove your love. This is very important. You gain lots of energy from mustahabbat. So, إِنَّهُ لَيَتَقَرَّبُ إِلَيَّ بِالنَّافِلَةِ. Okay. So, you have started your journey towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You go to certain distance by wajibat. After that, you keep going closer and closer by mustahabbat. Hatta أُحِبَّه. This is very important. This is the turning point. This continues till I love him. This is when you become muqarrab. So far you were mutaqarrab, you were seeking closeness. But when Allah loves you, it means that he chooses you as his beloved, then the situation changes. So this is like, you know, what we explain, you know, in philosophy. Sometimes when you want to have a change, you have to increase the volume, the quantity, and when the quantity reaches a certain level, then a substantial change happens. Before reaching that point, there is no substantial change. I give a simple example. This is not substantial change, but it helps. If you have a kettle full of water, you put it on fire. So, to certain extent, you increase the temperature, but nothing happens. It becomes hotter, hotter, hotter. Then all of a sudden, it starts boiling and steam comes out. This is the turning point. Increase in quantity caused change of quality. Okay? So, increase of nearness to Allah reaches a point that your quality is changed. You are accepted now by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Before that, you are not accepted. حَتَّى أُحِبَّهُ. I love him. فَإِذَا أَحْبَبْتُهُ When I love him, then many things happen. Before I explain what happens, I want to answer one question that might come to your mind. Maybe some of you say, isn't it that Allah loves everyone? Why Allah says, I love him? He loves everyone. At least he loves all the mu'mineen. So why he says, hatta uhibbah? The answer is that, yes, Allah loves everyone. But for most of people, Allah loves them with reservations. Allah says, I love you, but there are these problems in you that I don't love. For some people, there are hundreds of problems. For some people, maybe there are thousands of problems. For some people, maybe few problems. So Allah loves them, but not fully. But these are the people that their goodness has prevailed. So either there is no problem or the problems can be ignored. So Allah loves them. They become mahbub. They become beloved of Allah. But those who have lots of problems, Allah loves them, but with reservations. So these are my beloved ones. فَإِذَا أَحْبَبْتُهُ When I love them, كُنْتُ سَمْعَهُ الَّذِي يَسْمَعُ بِهِ I will become his ear by which he listens. How much trust is there? As you remember last night I said, if someone wants to make sure that the king accepts his request, he says, let me find a one who is muqarrab, because he's trusted. If he says something, it will be accepted. If I say something, it will not be accepted. First of all, they don't give me chance to speak to the king. And even if I say, they say, okay, this is a claim. But they trust muqarrab. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala so much loves these people and so much trust he has for them that not only he would consider that person as his own ear and eye, he says, I become his ear and eye. This is something that no king would say. This is something that no one would say to his muqarrab other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If the king has full trust in someone, what would be the maximum that the king says? If he has complete trust in someone, the maximum says, he is my eye. This man is my eye. This man is my ear. This is the maximum. The king never says, I am his eye. I am his ear. I am his hand. There is no such humbleness in a king to say, I am his eye. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is so kind and so supportive of his servants that he says, I become his ear, I become his eye, I become his hand. In a sense, it means that I will now start serving him. كُنْتُ سَمْعَهُ الَّذِي يَسْمَعُ بِهِ I will be his ear by which he listens. وَبَصَرَهُ الَّذِي يُبْصَرُ بِهِ I will be his eye by which he can see. وَاللِّسَانَهُ الَّذِي يَنْتَقُ بِهِ I will become his tongue. وَيَدَهُ الَّتِي يَبْتَشُ بِهَا I will become his hand by which he holds things. You know, you have to reflect. We don't have time to do it now. But you have to reflect. What would happen if your eye is now not anymore your eye? It is eye of Allah. If your hand is in the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or Allah is your hand, if Allah is your tongue, you know, you have to reflect, what would happen? What would you be able to see when Allah is your eye that you are not able to see now? What would you be able to understand when Allah is your ear? How you would be able to convince millions of people when Allah is your tongue? Okay? So these are the things that you have to reflect. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, in da'ani ajabtu. This person, whenever he calls me, I will say, here I am. It's impossible that he calls me and I say, I am busy with someone else, or I don't have attention or interest in you. In da'ani ajabtuhu. Wa in sa'alani a'taytuhu. And if he asks me for something, I will grant. There are two things. One is dua, one is su'al. Dua doesn't necessarily involve a request. You can do dua without asking anything. We all, you know, almost maybe everyone, you know, think that dua must always come with a haja, with a request. But this is not the case. Dua can be without haja. When you say Ya Allah, this is dua, even if you don't ask for anything. Dua means to call. When you call, Allah answers. Then you ask something, He grants. Of course, for these people, for many people He may not grant, because they don't really call Him. They are speaking to the God that is in their mind, not to the real God. So, such people, when they call me, I answer. When they ask, I give. And there is a beautiful ending that I don't have time, so I don't mention. So now, if you reflect on this hadith and compare it to what we said about muqarrabin, you find that this is really the same. The people who have performed their wajibat and then they keep doing mustahabbat, this continuous service to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes them servant. This is a very important point. Continuous service must make you servant, not like shaitan. Shaitan for 6,000 years worshipped Allah, never became servant, because he didn't know why he's worshipping Allah. He was just physically making himself tired. Even after 6,000 years, he didn't achieve servitude. He didn't become servant of Allah. He was just a worshipper, not a servant. But if you do it properly, you should then move from a worshipper to a servant, from abid to abd. Then you will be beloved of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then whatever you want, Allah will give you. Whatever you want for other people, also Allah will give you. Allah will not disappoint such people. And then Allah will act on your behalf. So your success then would be not success of any ordinary person. You sometimes see there are people, even, you know, we see in our age, there have been people that they had similar life like other people. They have eaten the same food as us. They have, you know, breathed the same air as us. But you see how blessed their life was. They changed life of millions of people. There are people in our age that we have seen how they have changed the entire world. There are people who have educated millions of people. If you look at, you know, our ulama, if you look at, you know, for example, Ayatollah Mutahhari, look at Allama Tabatabai, if you look at Imam Khomeini, how they changed lives of millions of people. Even not only Shia, not only Muslims, even, you know, sometimes the whole world is changed. It's not one person doing all these things. It's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala helping His servant. Allah putting barakah in the word of His servant. Because this person has gone through all the tests and has proved that he is not selfish. He doesn't want anything for himself. He doesn't want to become famous. He doesn't want people to praise him. MashaAllah, you give good lectures, you know, you convert, you know, many people to become good people. No. These people only want to be an agent for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, this is one hadith. Another hadith is, again, a hadith Qudsi. It's mentioned in several books. like Irshadul Qulub by Daylami. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam,
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
I'm sorry, there's a silver Audi blocking the vehicles. I believe you can kindly make space for them. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
فَإِذَا أَحَبَّنِي أَحْبَبْتُهُ. The same thing that we had, فَإِذَا أَحْبَبْتُهُ. Here also, Allah says, when He loves me, I love Him, then what happens? The turning point is the same, أَحْبَبْتُهُ. وَأَفْتَحُ عَيْنَ قَلْبِهِ إِلَى جَلَالِ. I open the eyes of his heart to my glory. It means that my glory is hidden. Not everyone can see my glory. My glory would be disclosed to these people. I show my beauty to the people that I trust, to the people who are my beloved. I don't, you know, show my beauty, the sweetness of talking to me, the sweetness of ibadah, munajat, to everyone. But to these people, I open the eye of their heart so that they can see my glory. And then, فَلَا أُخْفِي عَلَيْهِ خَاصَّةَ خَلْقِي. Or in some versions, فَلَا أُخْفِي عَلَيْهِ إِلْمَ خَاصَّةَ خَلْقِي. I would not conceal, I would not hide from him the select of my creation or the knowledge about the select of my creation. You know, if you have a person who is really trusted and loved by you, you would let him know your, I don't know, account details, you know, what is the PIN code for your safe. Even when you have to do something, you may go and say, you take over of my office. Few days I want to travel. You do all the business. Because you have trust in him. You love him. You know he's not going to betray. Over years he has proved that he has interest only in serving you. So Allah says, I will not hide from him anything. فَأُنَاجِيهِ في ظلم الليل. What is munajat? Whisper. Munajat means that you feel very close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so you whisper to him. Okay? Prophet Musa alayhi salam asked Allah, oh Allah, are you far so that I call, or you are near so I whisper? أَبَعِيدٌ أَنْتَ فَأُنَادِيكَ أَنْ قَرِيبٌ أَنْتَ فَأُنَاجِيكَ. So do I need, you know, to call, you know, and shout? Or you are very close, I whisper. And Allah said, أَنَا جَلِيسُ مَنْ ذَكَرَنِي. I am sitting next to the one who remembers me. If you remember me, I am sitting next to you. Even you don't need to whisper. You have to remember me. So, munajat means you feel very close to Allah and you whisper to Allah. Yeah? But Allah says here something else. Allah says, these are the people that I whisper to them. I do munajat with them. فَأُنَاجِيهِ فِي ظُلَمِ اللَّيْلِ وَنُورِ النَّهَارِ. In the darkness of night and the light of the day, I whisper to them. Means I communicate to them. I tell them things that other people don't know. You understand? حتى ينقطع حديثه مع المخلوقين. Then I so much attract him towards myself. Then he doesn't want to speak to anyone. He is fully absorbed and attracted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he doesn't want to speak to anyone. Even if he's speaking to someone, he's thinking of Allah. Unlike us, that when we speak to Allah, we are speaking to our, you know, wife and children. These are opposite. They are speaking with people, but they don't have presence of heart when they speak with people. They have their heart with Allah. It's quite opposite to our experience. So it's not that these people, you know, go and live in a cave because they don't want to speak with anyone. No, they are in the society. They are actually very active. But they cannot forget Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Their mind is there. حَتَّى يَنْقَطَعَ حَدِيثُهُ مَعَ الْمَخْلُوقِينَ وَمُجَالَسَتُهُ مَعْهُمْ. He doesn't sit with people. Either it means that he reduces his contact, or it means that he sits with them, but he is not really with them. You know, we have this saying, كُنْ فِي النَّاسِ وَلَا تَكُنْ مِنْهُمْ. Be among people, but don't be one of them. So you can be with the people, but keep your privacy. Keep your connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't forget to whom you belong. وَأُسْمِعُهُ كَلَامِ. I make him listen to my word. Or I make my word come to him. وَكَلَامَ مَلَائِكَتِي. He can listen to the word of my angels. Now, for example, Allah says in the Quran about angels speaking to people, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا رَبُّنَا اللَّهِ ثُمَّ اسْتَقَامُوا تَتَنَزَّلُ عَلَيْهِمُ الْمَلَائِكَةِ أَلَّا تَخَافُوا وَلَا تَحْزَنُوا وَأَبْشِرُوا بِالْجَنَّةِ الَّتِي كُنْتُمْ تُوْعَدُونَ. Those who say Allah is our Lord, and then they are persistent. They don't, you know, change. They don't, you know, deviate. Allah sends his angels to them. تَتَنَزَّلُ عَلَيْهِمُ الْمَلَائِكَةِ. And then the angels speak to them. لَا تَخَافُوا وَلَا تَحْزَنُوا. Don't have any fear. Don't have any grief. And receive the good news of heaven that you were promised. So it means that angels speak to these people. But our problem is that even if supposedly angels speak to us, we don't understand. If angels are around us, we don't understand. But these are the people that Allah enables them to understand the word of the angels. As we have in the case of Quran, for example, the Prophet Ibrahim and wife of Ibrahim had conversation with the angels. So it's possible. As we have in the life of Allama Tabatabai, I don't know if you have heard the story that he saw an angel, but his teacher had told him not to pay attention when you are doing this a'mal. So he says that the angel came from one side. I remembered what my teacher Ayatollah Ghazi told me, so I didn't pay attention. Then the angel came from the other side. I didn't pay attention, and then the angel left with sad face. And he says, I can never forget that sad face. So it's possible to see and to listen to the angels. We unfortunately don't have this experience because we are covered. Not that they are covered. They are not covered, we are covered. Now sometimes, you know, there is something very clear here, but I have closed my eyes. This is my problem. But unfortunately, we think they are hidden. We say they are ghaib. They are not ghaib. We are blinded. Okay? According to our limited understanding, we say they are ghaib. Otherwise, they are not ghaib. They are more shuhud than us. Anyway. وَأُعَرِّفُهُ السِّرَّ الَّذِي سَتَرْتُهُ عَنْ خَلْقِي. I teach him the secret which I have hidden from people. وَأُلْبِسُهُ الْحَيَاةِ حَتَّى يَسْتَحْيِي مِنْهُ الْخَلْقِ كُلُّهُمْ. I cover him with awe, with such a respect and awe that without him being a, you know, harsh person, but people, you know, respect him and even sometimes have difficulty to talk to him. They cannot look at him even. You know, he's such a charismatic person that people feel that he's not an ordinary person. Some people want to do this artificially. This is not good. You know, I speak very nicely, slowly, you know, I act in the way that people respect me. No, you have to be natural. If Allah wants to give you this, you don't need to do anything. It comes itself. This artificial, you know, things are very dangerous for yourself and for other people. It must come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, this is what can happen to a person who is muqarrab. This is real happiness. Because you are connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, therefore you have the best reason for being happy. Because you have the greatest understanding of the most beautiful, the most perfect, the most lovely being. And you are so much absorbed by this that nothing can make you worried. لا تخافوا ولا تحزنوا إن أولياء الله لا خوف عليهم ولا هم يحزنون. The same thing is repeated in Quran in many different places. There is no reason for you to worry. Yes, sometimes these people, they look at themselves and again they become worried. This is very important. As long as they are looking at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is no worry. But then they look at themselves, they become very worried. What would happen to me if I lose this connection with Allah? What about all my problems? What about all my shortcomings? I shouldn't forget that. You know, there's a beautiful story about Ayaz. Ayaz was a normal, you know, person. He didn't have any high position. Just was a like servant. But gradually, the king Mahmud Ghaznavid loved him very much and showed lots of respect to him, to the extent that some people became jealous. Some ministers, you know, some people in the court, they become jealous. So they started looking for some, you know, things so that they can use it against Ayaz and bring him down. So one day they told the king, this Ayaz is doing something very, you know, strange. He has a room. He doesn't let anyone to go to that room. He goes there and locks the room. And then after some time comes out and again locks the room. We think he is planning, you know, making some plots against you. The king said, no, I trust him. They said, no, this is definitely the case. So the king said, let's go and see what is in the room of Ayaz. Ayaz said, please let me go first, clean the room, because the king is coming to my room. I have to make it clean. They said, no, if he goes earlier, he may change. So they went together. When they went to the room, they saw there is nothing special. The only thing special was there was a very old and, you know, torn apart dress hanging on the wall. So they asked, what is this dress? King asked the, you know, servant, this Ayaz. Ayaz said, this is the dress that I used to put on before I became your servant. Now I have, you know, my khal'at, my dress of honor the king has given me. But this was my dress. I have put it here on the wall. Every day I come here, sit for some time, look at this and say, this is your position when you didn't have the king. Don't forget what you had before. Don't become proud now. So the king even loved him more. That such a, you know, humble and, you know, grateful person. So it's very important that you don't forget that whatever Allah gives you is not because you deserve. Because if you think that this is what you deserve, this is end of your success. You say, Alhamdulillah, I was a pious person. I did, you know, all my wajibat. I did mustahabat. I served people. So Allah is, you know, appreciative. If you say this, then you are either stuck or you will be going down. Anything good that we have is the gift that Allah gives, but He gives this gift to the people who make some efforts. But it's still the gift. It's not what you deserve. You know the story of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. One night, his wife saw that the Prophet is leaving the room. She wanted to see where is the Prophet going. Then saw that the Prophet has gone to a very private place, quiet place, and is asking forgiveness, is praising Allah, is crying. So she said to the Prophet, why do this? Allah has chosen you as a prophet. Allah has forgiven all your sins. لِيَغْفَرَ لَكَ اللَّهُ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِكَ وَمَا تَأْخَرَ. Whatever the meaning of sin is. Of course, the sin here doesn't mean sin like sinful people that we normally use. Why you need to do this? The Prophet said, أَفَلَا أَكُونُ عَبْدًا شَكُورًا. Shouldn't I be grateful? Do you want me to think that I am a good person and Allah has given me all these things because of me? No. I know that I don't deserve these things. It's gift of Allah, the blessing of Allah. I have to be thankful. I should not forget that I am by myself nothing. So, if they have fear, because you know, sometimes in Quran, you find that even the Ahlul Bayt, they have fear. إِنَّا نَخَافُ مِنْ رَبِّنَا يَوْمًا عَبُوسًا قَمْطَرِيرًا. So is there a contradiction? Allah says, إِنَّا أَوْلِيَاءَ اللَّهِ لَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ. But here says, إِنَّا نَخَافُ مِنْ رَبِّنَا يَوْمًا عَبُوسًا قَمْطَرِيرًا. No, there is no contradiction. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling that awliya Allah, they don't need to have fear. لا خوف عليهم. But as soon as they think about themselves, they become worried. When they think about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is only hope. But when they look at themselves, they become worried. And this is what brings balance. If you forget your problems, then you become too proud. If you only think about your problems, then you become hopeless. So the balance is, you have one eye to your shortcomings and problems and one eye to the generosity of Allah, forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to the people who have become close to Him, there is no need for you to worry. لا تخافوا ولا تحزنوا. But they are still worried. You know, sometimes I use this example. You know, when you go to Hajj, okay? So the people who go there for the first time, they have lots of fears and worries and, you know, they're very stressful. So you tell them, there is no reason to worry. Every year, millions of people come and perform their Hajj and go back. And inshallah, you are also one of them. You shouldn't worry. But at the same time, still that person worries. And indeed, it is good that he worries to some extent. Why? Because then he listens carefully to the instructions. Those who don't worry, they don't listen. So sometimes you have problem with people who have been once to Hajj, because they don't come to lectures, they don't listen, they think they know everything, and then you realize they made mistakes. But those who are worried, but to a balanced degree, not too much, indeed these are the people who are very careful and they do everything properly. You keep telling them, don't worry. But it's good that they worry to some extent. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ. There is no need to have any fear. But still, they may have some fear when they look at themselves. So this type of life in the Quran is called Hayata Tayyibah. Why it is called Hayata Tayyibah? Inshallah, we will explain tomorrow. What does Tayyib mean and how it can be achieved? Let us read few couplets about Lady Zainab Salamullah Alayha. Inshallah, our brother is going to come and inshallah, we will benefit. As-salamu alayka ya Aba Abdullah wa ala al-arwahi allati halat bifinaik alayka minni salamullah أبدا ما بقيت وبقي الليل والنهار ولا جعله الله آخر العهد مني لزيارتكم السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين وعلى زينب أخت الحسين أنك الشام وكوف ربا خطب ويران ميكوند بالساني دل نشين بی ترس و پرواز زینب است The one who can change شام and کوفه The one who can destroy the palace of Yazid and Ibn Ziyad with her word without any fear is Zainab. با دو دست بست همراه اسیران بلا شاهد آیات قرآن روی نیها زینب The one with her hands being tied up by enemies and moving with the captives from Ahlul Bayt and seeing the head of Imam Hussein on his spear reciting Quran is Zainab. آنکه از هر بام و در سنگ جفایش میزنند سینه میسازد سپر در نزد اعدا زینب است The one to whom the enemy threw stones from the roofs of Sham and still she stood against the tyrants is Zainab. چهره نیلی و پیکرم چنان مادر که بود، روز خان مجلس شام غم افزا زینب است. The one whose face is bruised, her body is bruised like her mother. The one who remembers the suffering and tragedy of Imam Hussein in the majlis of Yazid is Zainab. آنکه مویش شد سپید و قامتش همچون کمان، در میان دشت خون بر حفظ گلها زینب است. The one whose hair became white, his body bent, but she still wanted to protect in that plain of blood the children of Hussein was Zainab. آنکه داغ شش برادر می کشد در نیم روز، باز اسب عشق می تازد تنها زینب است. The one who loses six brothers together in half a day and still she remains brave and persistent is زینب. الغرض آن کس که فتح کربلا در دست اوست، می خروشد در طرف مانند دریا زینب است. The one who brought victory to the movement of Hussein is زینب. ألا لعنة الله على القوم الظالمين.